Please, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Neville for a moment of silence.
My intent this evening, knowing that we're going into budget, the first part of the budget process, was to make some comments and ask some blessing on the budget process, that we have some wisdom in that process. However, as I was leaving my house, I heard the news, and unfortunately, there was another school shooting that happened in New Mexico. A 12-year-old middle school youngster ended up wounding two fellow students until the teacher stepped in and stopped it. So I'd ask that you please keep these students and their parents in your thoughts and prayers, and also pray that this type of incident and terror in this country of ours stops. Pledge allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, in the event of a fire, our fire exits are immediately to the back or out to my left and down the stairs to the parking lot. Can we have roll call, Mr. Trezick?
Sure. Mr. Grady? Ms. LeBlanc? Mr. Neville?
Yes.
Mrs. Thurston? Yeah. Mr. Janitis? Mrs. Unghire?
Here.
Mr. Waller?
Present.
Chairman Sirard?
Present. Now, board guests.
We have no board guests at this time. There will be some during the superintendent's report.
Very good. Dr. Schumann, the superintendent's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just take a second to get our technology ready, and then we'll be ready to go. Watching to see when you get it here. There we go. I'm not sure when it switches over for you guys.
Do we have the remote control for the TV?
It should be in your drawer.
We switch it over, or is they get the live feed from the TV?
Well, they get the feed from the TV, so the ETV's got to switch it over.
Want me to go down there?
Please.
Please bear with us while we deal with the technical difficulties.
We're ready to go in the front of the house, or the back of the house.
Dr. Schumann, if you feel comfortable, you can go ahead and start.
No, I want you guys to be able to, you know, I'll be talking about a presentation that's up here that you won't be able to see. So. Katie can see it.
It's not there.
You found it?
Not getting the presentation, though.
Our motto, I'll get everybody on the same page.
Yes.
Or the same screen as it would be. There we go. Okay. All right, so I'd like to present to you a proposed spending plan for the 2014-2015 school year. And our vision is to develop a world-class educational system today. As we think about the things we need to do in order to accomplish this, there's many things to consider. First of all, we have to consider the needs of our students and our parents, and our teachers. We consider the needs and the priorities of the Board of Education. Of course, we need to address the underfunded mandates that come to us from the state and federal government. And each individual school has taken the time to think about the things that they need to address in order to make their schools better, and they have their school improvement plans. We roll all those together as we put together the budget presentation. And preparing the budget is challenging and rewarding. It's rewarding because we get to look at our accomplishments, and it's challenging because we realize there's many things that we need to accomplish as we go forward. But we'll start tonight by looking back in order to see what's in front of us. Some of the things we've been able to accomplish. Enfield students earned the highest CAP score they've ever earned in the last 12 years. Board of Education, along with the staff and the community, has implemented a full-day kindergarten program. If you're watching the news these days and in the newspapers, there's a lot of communities envious of us trying to get this done, and you were able to accomplish that last year. We are in the first year of a three-year partnership with LEGO, and we have begun the Building Tomorrow project. It's implemented right now in grades kindergarten, 2 and 4, and we're in the process of developing the program for grades 1, 3, and 5, and next year we'll be running full K-5 Building Tomorrow project in all of our elementary and intermediate schools. We have a long history with FIRST Robotics, and you're going to see a presentation tonight, but they're entering their 20th year working with FIRST Robotics. And this past year, we entered into the first LEGO League competition with a group over at JFK. And as you'll hear about in the budget presentation tonight, we want to expand our experiences and give our kids more opportunities in the area FIRST. We are building global connections. And tonight, in the very front row next to Ms. McKernan, is Dr. Soki Cho from St. John's University. She was here about a month ago with 8 high-ranking education officials from Korea, and they visited our schools, and they spent some time with us. And tomorrow, she'll be bringing 31 teachers from Korea to the Enfield schools. We'll be starting at Fermi High School, and we'll be then going out and visiting Parkman and Whitney and Crandall schools. So it's beginning a conversation of the things that they do well and they want to learn how to do better and the things that we can learn from them. They'll be presenting to us tomorrow and we'll be presenting to them. Our middle school was recognized by the National Association of Middle Schools as a School of the Year finalist last year. Our high schools made the College Board AP Honor Roll. Only 17 schools in Connecticut made this, and only 477 schools across the United States made this. And we have a UAV club which has built a drone. And here's a look at what the drone looks like. This is the unmanned air vehicle. It was built over at Enfield High School. It does fly. It's being refined. Matter of fact, the prototype for the next machine is down in the lower left-hand corner. But their vision is to put a GPS monitoring system on this device with a video and a still camera. And they're going to program it to fly the same loop over Enfield High School every week during the construction and create a time-lapse photography history of what that project looks like. We're already doing those kinds of things right here in Enfield. But we have some challenges, and one is to provide excellent service to the students and families of Enfield through a fiscally responsible and efficient spending plan. Specifically, we need to meet the individual needs of all students within the precious resources that we have. And of course, we are bound to address a variety of federal and state underfunded mandates, and they will drive parts of this budget. We have a responsibility. We have several responsibilities. One is to ensure that all students show academic growth. Every student must attain high-level content knowledge in humanities and STEAM subjects taught by expert teachers. Every student must have the opportunity to learn in a safe, individually designed learning environment. And every student must have 21st century skills to compete in the global marketplace. We talk a lot about 21st century skills, but specifically, we're talking about written communication, information technology, the ability to think critically and to solve problems, to be innovators and creators, and to have leadership opportunities, as well as to learn how to collaborate with others to increase their leadership capacity. The budget development process is a lengthy one. It takes about 3 months. We start at the classroom level with teachers identifying the things that they need. And the teachers meet with principals and department chairs, and they talk about that. Then the principals and department chairs make recommendations to the superintendent and the cabinet. The superintendent refines and prioritizes their requests. And tonight I'll be presenting to you a prioritized budget based on the request of all of the members of our staff. After tonight, the Board of Education will review and eventually adopt a budget. Then they will make a presentation. And they'll make a presentation to our town council. Our town council will make an appropriation, which will come back to the board, and then we will move forward into the next fiscal year. So what are the budget components? They're very simple. We have salary side. We're in a people business. We have lots of folks who work for us, almost 1,000 employees, and almost 5,100 students. We have the non-salary side, which is everything but the money to pay our the people. We add those two items together, we have our total budget. So if we look a little bit at salary data, up in the green, we have our existing cost for salaries this year, $43.2 million. With our contractual obligations, if we roll that up, just take those same people and pay them what they're entitled to by the agreements we have agreed to, it's going to cost us $1.1 million to do that. During the budget process, $1.6 million of new positions were requested by our staff. If we take all that together, it's $46.13 million, or a 6.6% raise on the salary side of the budget. Positions that were requested, there were 29.9 new positions requested. Four were requested in the area of intervention specialists, such as social workers, psychologists, instructional coaches, and counselors. Seven assistant principals were requested, nine classroom and support teachers, 8.5 speech, English language learner, occupational physical therapist, and special education teachers, and 1.4 clerical positions. The non-salary side of the budget is everything else. Things like athletic supplies and uniforms. A big driver of our budget, magnet school tuition. Transportation for students in and out of the district. Classroom instructional supplies. Art and music equipment and supplies, textbooks, and technology equipment and supplies. All those together make up the non-salary side of our budget. This year we're spending $21 million on the non-salary side. The roll-up costs are $1.7 million. We have new requests for $4.1 million of new things. That would total $26.8 million, or a 28% rise in that side of the budget. We put all that together, what are we looking at? Well, our total budget for this year is $64,262,157. Our roll-up costs are 4.5%. The requested needs, things that people asked for and made good arguments for, are another 9%. If we were to completely fund all the requests plus the roll-up, we would need $73 million, or a 13.64% budget increase. And this is where my work begins. I realize that balancing what our needs are and the ability of the community to pay wouldn't work at 13.64%. So we had to make some changes. Our greatest needs fall in two areas: enhanced professional capacity and STEAM education. And so all of the things that we're going to move forward tonight will be directly related to one or the other of these two items. We'll start with enhanced professional capacity. We believe every person will learn as long as we provide a pathway to that learning. We believe great teachers design learning experiences, not deliver curriculum. And we believe it is our responsibility, and our district must provide learning experiences for every person in our organization if we're to grow and if we're to enhance the professional capacity. Now, these three arrows that you see here are measurements that are being used by a lot of different people around the world in measuring the capacity of school districts: human capacity, social capital, and decisional capacity. As you get a ranking on each one, if you were to plot a point where you fall on each one of those axes, and then you will fill it in with a triangle. Where's my triangle? Here we go. you get an area. And the area covered by that triangle is the professional capacity of your organization. This triangle represents the area being covered by countries such as Finland and Korea. This area represents the area being covered by the United States. We have work to do. We have work to do to grow our capacity in a lot of different directions so that we can meet the needs of our students. Some of the ways that we hope to enhance our professional capacity. We need to add some positions. We need to add social worker and school counselors at our elementary level to address the needs and the challenges that our students face every day and their families face. We need to have them ready to learn when they come to school. We need to continue our monthly professional development. We need to tailor to the individual needs of every teacher. We need to promote teacher collaboration. We have to find opportunities for our teachers to observe each other and share best practices. One of the ways we started that last year was the forum, the online professional development feature that Ms. McKernan has put together. We're going to continue to grow that and use that. And we're asking for elementary assistant principals, and this was a request that was in last year's budget as well. We all know that with the new evaluation demands, it's going to be very taxing. We will not be able to meet those demands with the staff that we have. But we also have a variety of student issues. What we're finding after the reorganization, especially at our intermediate level, was that there's an awful lot of student engagement that has to happen in order for those schools to run smoothly. And one principal trying to do that with another 45 adults, when you add up everybody in the building, our principals are just spread too thin. And they need help, and they need assistance, and we believe we can do it with assistant principals at the elementary level. We look at the other side of the diagram before, the STEAM side. This is a conversation that took place about a week and a half ago. In the center is Dean Kamen. He is the founder of FIRST. To the left is Governor Maggie Hassan of New Hampshire. And we're talking a lot about STEAM education. We're talking about the things at the bottom of the page there. The FIRST opportunities through robotics for our and tech challenges for our students. And we have the FIRST Lego League in the center there, and to the left of that, the FIRST, the Junior FIRST Lego League. And we have FIRST Tech Challenge, and then we have the FIRST Robotics, which we've had with our Buzz Robotics Club here. But one of the things the governor said while we were there speaking, she said there's going to be 46,000 STEAM-related jobs created in New Hampshire by 2018. And she said her goal was to not only educate the children in New Hampshire, but to be out in front and take the best and the brightest from the other states and bring them to New Hampshire. So we're going to talk in a minute about our roadmap to get our students prepared for those jobs. But before we do that, I want you to listen to Dean Kamen, because he's going to tell us a little bit about why STEAM jobs and this kind of technology and creators and innovators are going to be very important as we move forward.
I got a visit just almost exactly a year ago, a little over a year ago, from a very senior person at the Department of Defense. Came to see me and said, 1,600 of the kids that we sent out have come back missing at least one full arm. Whole arm, shoulder disarticulated. And we're doing the same thing we did for more or less that we've done since the Civil War, a stick and a hook. And they deserve more than that. And literally this guy sat in my office in New Hampshire and said, I want you to give me something that we can put on these kids that'll pick up a raisin or a grape off a table. They'll be able to put it in their mouth without destroying either one. And they'll be able to know the difference without looking at it. You know, efferent, afferent, and haptic response. He finishes explaining that, and I'm waiting for the big 300-pound paper proposal, and he said, that's what I want from you. I said, look, you're nuts. That technology is just not available right now, and it can't be done. Not in an envelope of a human arm with 21 degrees of freedom from your shoulder to your fingertips. He said, about 24 of these 1,600 kids have come back bilateral. You think it's bad to lose one arm? That's an inconvenience compared to having both of them gone. I got a day job. And my nights and weekends are already filled up with things like, let's supply water to the world and power to the world and educate all the kids, which, Chris, I will not talk about. I don't need another mission. I keep thinking about these kids with no arms. He says to me, we've done some work around the country. We've got some pretty amazing neurology and other people. I said, I'll take a field trip. I'll go see what you got. Over the next month, I visited lots of places, some out here around the country, found the best of the best. I went down to Washington. I saw these guys and said, I did what you asked me. I looked at what's out there. I still think you're nuts, but not as nuts as I thought. I put a team together a little over 13 months ago. It got up to 20-some-odd people. We said, we're going to build a device that does what he wants. We have 14 out of the 21 degrees of freedom. You don't need the ones in your last two fingers. We put this thing together. A couple of weeks ago, we took it down to Walter Reed, which is unfortunately more in the news these days. We showed it to a bunch of guys. One guy who described himself as being lucky because he lost his left arm and he's a righty. He sat at a table with seven or eight of these other guys, said he was lucky because he had his good arm, and then he pushed himself back from the table. He had no legs. These kids have attitudes that you just can't believe. So I'm going to show you now without the skin on it, a 30-second piece, and then I'm done. But understand what you're looking at. We made small enough to fit on a 50th percentile female so that we could put it in any of these people. It's going to go inside something that we're using, CAT scans and MRIs of whatever is their good arm, to make a silicon rubber, then coated and painted in 3D, exact mirror image of their other limb. So you won't see all the really cool stuff that's in this series elastic set of 14 actuators, each one which has its own capability to sense temperature pressure. It also has a pneumatic cuff that holds it on, so the more they put themselves under load, the more it attaches. They take the load off and it becomes, again, compliant. There's Randy. These guys are passing a rubber little puck between them. And just as in the spirit of first, gracious professionalism, they're quite proud of this, so they decide to share a drink. This is a non-trivial thing to do, by the way. Imagine doing that with a wooden stick and a hook on the end of it, doing either of those. Now Chuck is doing something quite extraordinary, at least for my limited physical skill. And now he's going to do what DARPA asked me for. He's going to pick up a grape. He didn't drop it. He didn't break it. And he's going to eat it. So that's where we were at the end of about 15 months. I was talking to one of them, and he was really liking this arm. It's way, way, way better than a plastic stick with a hook on it. But there's nobody in this room that would rather have that than the one you got. But I was saying to him, you know, the first airplane went 100 feet in 1903, the Wilbur and Orville, but you know what? It wouldn't have made an old pigeon jealous. But now we got Eagles out there, F-15s, even that bald eagle. I've never seen a bird flying around at Mach 2. I think eventually we'll make these things extraordinary. And I said to that kid, I'll stop when your buddies are envious of your Luke arm because of what it can do and how it does it. And we'll keep working. And I'm not going to stop working until we do that. And I think this country ought to continue its great debate, whining and complaining, I'm entitled, you're a victim. And whining and complaining about what our foreign policy ought to be. But while we have the luxury of whining and complaining about who's paying for what and how much we get, the people that are out there giving us that great privilege of whining and complaining, I know what they deserve. Everything humanly possible. And we ought to give it to them.
Dean came and talked about a lot of the 21st century skills. He talked about problem solving. He talked about creativity. He talked about collaboration. He talked about putting a team together. He talked about taking on things that weren't conceivable and weren't possible because we need to, because it's the only way we can move forward. Our roadmap to prepare our students for those kinds of challenges looks like this. We have things on the left side in the curricular area and things on the right side in the co-curricular area. We envision every student being exposed to the curricular enhancements and those that are really interested in this kind of work taking advantage of the co-curricular things. At the primary level, we have the LEGO Bill for Tomorrow project in inquiry-based science. We're going to offer the first LEGO League for those children interested, as well as inquiry-based field trips. At the intermediate level, we have the LEGO Creativity Centers and science inquiry labs and project-based learning, co-curricular, first LEGO League, invention convention, and more field trips. At the middle school level, interdisciplinary project-based learning, tech-enhanced science inquiry labs, pre-engineering design strand, and the invention convention at grade 6. In the co-curricular, the first tech challenge and first LEGO League, STEM Girls Expo, interdisciplinary field trips, and the Da Vinci Art Math Club. And at the high school, in our new, brand new STEAM wing, Project Lead the Way, a variety of new STEAM electives, computer programming pathways, expanded AP and early college experience offerings, and a STEAM capstone project. And we have the ACE Mentoring, partnerships with higher ed and industry, our UAV club, our first robotics opportunities, and internships out in the field. These are the things that will help us prepare our students to make this a better world and make them ready to take on all those jobs that are going to be available to them. So if you look at the total budget dollars, we had a request for $73 million. Through the work of myself and the cabinet, we've removed $5.5 million from those requests. We're presenting a budget of $67,463,196. If you look at the way that breaks out, $947,000 are needed to cover our salary increases. Our information technology increase is $536,000. In order to do the enhanced professional capacity things that we want to do, $834,000. Our STEAM initiatives, $97,000. All of the things on that non-salary side, those increases, $785,000. The budget would go up $3.2 million from last year, or a 4.98% budget increase. The impact. This budget recognizes the desire of the community to maintain a high-quality school district with limited economic resources. We know that families make decisions to relocate based on the quality and reputation of the school system. We believe we're building a high quality and a good reputation here in Enfield. We believe this budget makes Enfield one of the most fiscally responsible, respected, and forward-thinking communities in the state of Connecticut. So we started today by looking back so we could see what was in front of us. And we want to finish by looking both backwards and forwards. We're going to begin by looking back to August of 2012 at the first convocation we had since the cabinet and I came to Enfield.
I imagine all children and adults in the Enfield schools learning and growing at high levels.
If we come forward to this past August at convocation, we introduced our new logo, one that makes us remember always that we are trying to build a world-class system and prepare our students for the global community they live in.
We can be the best in the world. So our students can be the best for the world. We can develop the next generation of creators, of innovators, and world leaders.
In the center, we see Einstein. And Einstein told us we needed to think differently. And our students are going to have to think differently. They're going to have to think about machinery. They're going to have to think about making connections. They're going to have to think about more connections. And they're going to have to think about that on a global scale. They're going to have to think in that kind of streamline. That's the streamline of thinking they're going to need if they're going to be changing the world. World-class leaders and innovators of tomorrow, of the future, will come from somewhere. I believe it'll be our kids that change the world. And Nelson Mandela told us that education is the most powerful weapon with which we can change the world. So we look forward to the next several weeks working with the Board of Education, talking in depth about the things that we've proposed, working to bring our budget in line with the board's thinking, and then getting ready to pass our budget on to the town council for their review. But it's a wonderful process. We believe that we can move our school district forward, and we are here to work with you. In the next couple of minutes, Mr. Dresick has a budget book for you. It has everything in detail for you to begin to review the budget. And while we're doing that, we're going to ask Mr. Barassa to come up and set up, because we have the folks from Buzz Robotics here, and they're going to give you a presentation on their club. So I thank you for your time. I think I pressed it when I set it down.
It was all set and ready for it.
Just the things to look at.
But to bring you guys back to the gym. Matt, we have.
We've been talking about that.
You didn't get it. Good catch.
Yeah.
Take it easy. I'm all done. Yes. You're gonna hit the right button to advance it. And when you get to your movie, it's gonna play automatically.
Oh, is that right?
But it should play automatically.
Thank you very much.
You can stand over here and you can see it. Okay, you'll see what's coming up next. It's all there. I don't know. I'm going to give him your jet pack there.
I think so. Yeah. And I can walk around too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Robot is getting assistance out. Bob, I'll introduce you.
I see you, huh? Yeah. You.
Ready?
Go ahead, Doctor.
Okay. Tonight we have Bob Scagney with us. Bob is one of the engineers who was here when Buzz Robotics was founded 19 years ago. Bob has been involved with FIRST. He's a very active member. He's well-respected within the FIRST community. And a week and a half ago, he was my chaperone as he took me up to Dean Kamen's house and showed me how everything goes forward with FIRST and their big reception and the kickoff. And through the conversations I've had with him, I've got a whole new understanding of what they are and what they're trying to accomplish and how valuable their mission is. And so he is here to tell you a little bit about the history of FIRST and also Buzz Robotics as they've been working through and been here in the town of Enfield. So, Bob, we'll turn it over to you.
Okay, thank you. I came here, and I've seen your presentation now, and I see that you focus in quite a bit on Dean Kamen. And Dean Kamen is the entrepreneur, inventor that has been involved with FIRST since its beginning 22 years ago. And we've been involved from the United Technologies point of view since 95, 96. And Dean has a way of going after business, and he's all business in his mind. And he really, what he says and what you'll see in a video in a minute, he's been consistent with that all 19 years. We could almost give his speeches and stuff. I mean, it's that good. But he's a entrepreneur, inventor, the portable dialysis or insulin pumps, the iBot, which is a wheelchair that walks up and down stairs, the Segway, which we're probably all familiar with, was, and business-wise, he's so sharp that he develops the business, and he doesn't hang on to it forever. He sells it off. He makes contacts. All his contacts he uses for developing new entrepreneurial type things. So that's the story with Dean. Let me go. Okay, his first vision is to transform our culture by creating a world where science and technology are celebrated and where young people dream of becoming science and technology leaders. That's what he started back, way back, and that's what he's continuing to do now. From there comes a mission statement: to inspire young people to be science and technology leaders by engaging them in exciting mentor-based programs that build science and engineering and technology skills that inspire innovation and that foster well-rounded life capabilities, including self-confidence, communication, and leadership. So by what I saw, is he is an ideal situation for a community. Okay, now, I think this is where the video comes up.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a short video on Dean, about 3 minutes long, and
press the button once.
Same one?
Yeah.
Nope. Want me to go back one?
This is the Super Bowl. The Super Bowl of smarts, that is. It's a life-changing competition. It's kids having fun, competing, working together to dream up, design, and build robots.
It's just an exhilarating feeling. It's like I'm using power tools.
They're having the hardest fun they'll ever have. And they're becoming our next generation of engineers and innovators. First,
come out!
For inspiration and recognition of science and technology, my teachers were some of the greatest influences on my life by challenging and trusting me. These mentors got me to understand that I could do anything I put my mind to. First mentors are changing kids' lives every day. Professional engineers, teachers, parents, teaming up with young people not just to build robots, but to build confidence and self-respect.
I'm around people that I can get along with, that we can talk computer lingo with.
First was founded by one of our greatest inventors, Dean Kamen. Dean saw that kids mostly look up to sports heroes and movie stars.
So we said, if we've got a culture now that's obsessed with sports and entertainment, let's inspire these kids to be big thinkers the same way Shaquille O'Neal can inspire them to spend dozens of hours a week bouncing a ball.
Our president agrees.
Scientists and engineers ought to stand side by side with athletes and entertainers as role models. And here at the White House, we're going to lead by example. We're going to show young people how cool science can be.
Go first!
250,000 kids aged 6 to 18 compete at all different levels. In two first Lego leagues, the first tech challenge. And at the high school level, the first robotics competition.
The only difference between this sport and all the others is every kid on our teams can turn pro. There's a job out there for every one of these kids.
Students who take part in FIRST are 50% more likely to go to college and twice as likely to major in science or engineering.
I definitely know that I want to pursue engineering.
Once they've tasted what the power of knowledge is, that it can be fun and rewarding, they won't go back.
There's no doubt, FIRST works.
10 or 15 or 20 years from today, some kid in those stands will have cured Alzheimer's or AIDS or cancer, or built an engine that doesn't pollute. Look at these kids. They're the future.
I feel like I can go and do anything I want to do because of this program.
Someone took the time to guide and inspire me. It changed my life. Take some time. Go to usfirst.org.
Now, this brings me to this slide here, and this is the evolution of how FIRST got started here in Enfield. Back in 95, 96, I was a friend, first of all, back up, at Hamilton, they came into me, into our staff meeting and said, is anyone interested in running a robotics program? And I didn't see too many hands go up. And what had happened was Dean was doing his talking to, and I'm saying talking, but conning big corporations now to get involved with a brainstorm that he had, is getting kids involved with what became FIRST. And he talked to United Technologies. United Technologies started feeding it out through all its divisions. There's Sikorsky, Pratt & Whitney, Otis, Carrier, big companies. And came down to our level at formerly Hamilton, Sunstrand. And Hamilton was looking to get a team started, and more specifically in space systems. So first time they asked, nothing. Second time, maybe. Because it was an unknown back then. You know, it had only been going for 3 years, and it had not developed into a program that it is today. So I said, I'll give it a try, but I need some mentors. And talked to the engineering manager. He came back and said, I didn't have much luck with getting any mentors, so I walked back in, or I talked to him and said, can I come to your meeting? And I presented it with a video and stuff like that, and lo and behold, a whole bunch of them came to my desk, and we're going. Now we need to marry it up with a school. So I talked to Steve Ross, who was a former assistant principal at the time, and then principal later on. I says, is this something that Enrico Fermi would be interested in having? Because that's where he was stationed. And I says, it's a good match. Enrico Fermi was a science type school, planetarium. This is a perfect fit, so let's give it a try. So that's what we did, and we developed into a team for the first year, you know, and we didn't know what we were doing, but we were competitive, and that's when there was we were team 51, not 175. And there was like 65 teams at that point after 3 years with Dean. Now, I'll show you some statistics later here. And so we got it going, and the department was funding it, and let's keep it moving. We got the Enfield School Systems involved. And lo and behold, we started working at it. And this is on the bottom here, industry and education working together. I totally believe in that concept. It's a must for the future as far as I'm concerned. Because it's where it's at. You need to educate to industry of some sort. Okay. Now, this is a picture we took up there. And I think it's important because this is the first time Enfield has supported us enough that Dr. Schumann came there, saw, talked to, and has now knows what we're talking about, because it's an ongoing conversation of what it really is. So he's firsthand, and it's a great thing. So, and then here we are up at the competition, and the day after where they suggest the game and talk to you about the game, and we're going through taking our measurements, because this is every year it's a game change. It's a new game. So when you get a new game, yeah, you're building a robot, but it's going to change. I'm holding back on a couple of things because these are some themes that are always going on here. Industry and education working together. STEM. This is the word, and you, I know you're doing STEAM, and this fits the STEAM, of course. And the program is mentor-driven. Now, these are people that are in industry, and I have 19 of them available, and they're working, and they keep rotating out, and they're over at the school right now trying to come up with strategies and concepts with the students of about 25 students. And the vehicle, just so it's not like always thought about that the robot is what we're all about, it's the vehicle for learning. It has programming, it has computer, programming, computer skills, mechanical, pneumatics. It goes right down the line of all kinds of different disciplines of engineering. And we go on a term of that was created by one of the fellow acquaintances that works with Dean Kamen, Woody Flowers, gracious professionalism. Well, that's sort of understood. However, we promote it, and the kids talk to each other and try to understand what gracious professionalism in its pure sense. You know, you can go in, you can lose, and you come out shaking hands, and you're all part of the same thing, and it's a good attitude. Okay, some of the information that we want to go down through here is total first FRC teams. Now, I told you we were team 51 at one time out of 65 at the beginning. There's 2,700 first robotics teams out there. In Connecticut, there's 45. UTC sponsors 73. That means all their divisions, and with their latest acquisition of Goodrich, they pick up a whole bunch more. We've been in the school system for 19 years. Now, a feather in our cap, in 2002, we won what they call the first Chairman's Award. And there's only 22 teams that have that title because they only give out one a year for the duration. And the Chairman's Award is the highest thing you could get in first. It's got to do with outreach. Nothing to do with the competition. You're out there, you're selling first, you understand the program, and you're out portraying first and everything else, and we had to do all kinds of things. It took us 4 years to get that. But that gives us the ability to go to the national championship every year, automatically. So all these teams are fighting their way to win a local or a district level, and we can go automatically. FIRST provides, through all the different universities, $16 million of potential college scholarships, and our students have won that. They've applied for it and have gotten it. Students in the BUZZ program since 95 is 475. And now why UTC is involved with it, and I think I've might have hit upon it a little bit, but UTC is in it for looking for engineers and fulfilling the work base that they need down the line. So we've had 15 interns come to Hamilton. Maybe not the same ones, but there's 10 employees at UTC Hamilton. Or I keep saying Hamilton, and forgive me, they keep changing their name. It used to be Hamilton Standard, Hamilton Sunstrand, and now it's UTAS, which is United Technologies Aerospace Systems, and specifically Space Systems. So there's 10 Hamilton employees there, engineers. And 10% of the U.S. high schools have FIRST teams. That's a number you probably want to know. And so it's like 1 out of 10 high schools might have a team. And I think, you know, we're fortunate to be part of that number. Now,
why don't we have you hold up here and see if the board members have any questions, and then if necessary, then we can explain to them what's in the rest of their book and let them go forward.
Are there any board members who have any questions?
Okay. In your book that Bob's provided for you, the next page you're going to see is this video. And this is an animated video that you can go and watch for yourself to see exactly what challenges we're working on over at Fermi High School 50-60 hours a week for the next 5 weeks.
We're going to skip that. Let me just hit the second one.
Okay.
This one here. This is the last slide in. In the preseason, we work from September to December on weekly meetings with the students, trying to get them up to speed. You need to have them knowing machinery and understanding the lingo, so to speak, between this September and December. Build season is going on right now between January and February. We've got 6 weeks to build the robot. Strategize, build it, test it, ship it, just like industry would. And the competition season is March and April. We will be competing in Hartford, Southington, and in Groton on the district level. If we get enough points there, or credits or whatever, it's a new system. They used to use regionals, now it's districts. We would move on to a Boston competition, which would be a regional, and then from there you go on to nationals. Now, I told you, we already go to nationals, so which is a big plus on our cap, and a lot of teams are envious of us being in that situation. So that pretty much tells you what it is. I gave you a book that shows a little how we work and some pictures and stuff like that. So that's pretty much all I have.
Great.
At this point.
Thank you, Bob.
Mr. Neville.
Good luck to you this year.
Yeah, thank
we'll
you.
Be biased.
Oh, and I also wish you'd stop by sometime and see what's going on. I mean, we're wide open. We have families and parents stopping by all the time. That's what we do. We want you to see what's going on.
Mr. Neville.
Bob, I appreciate, keep up the good work. I know this stuff. My own son was in there when he was in high school, and it was some of the best fun that he had, and he learned more than I can imagine during that time. And we did go to some of the events. I'd love you to come back when you get the robot going, maybe right
this
after the season, and put it on display here and doing its thing. I mean, I'm very, very pleased that Dr. Schum was able to catch that Frisbee there. I assume that was the task last year. That was last year's robot.
That was last year's robot.
So we're not sure what the task is this year, but we look forward to seeing it in action. Okay.
Thank you.
And thank you very much. We appreciate all the work you do.
If you have more questions or anything like that, I'd be happy to answer them in some form.
Bob, thank you very much for coming out tonight. I will tell you, you have a fan of Buzz Robotics and me. So
continue
the good work. Thank you.
Great.
Mr. Chairman, we have one of our two student representatives. We have Katie here from Fermi High School, and she has some information she'd like to share besides what's in our packet.
Go ahead, Katie.
Well, of course, I hope everyone had a great holiday season, and of course, we're now back to the normal routine after a somewhat extended vacation, thanks to all the snow. Last Thursday, on January 9th, six students from Fermi traveled to Wesleyan University with some teachers for the school day. In partnership with CIAC, they prepared speeches and presentations to teach lessons about teen leadership to a group of students that included many kids with Down syndrome and their mentors as well. And present at that program, there were many talented speakers as well. On Friday, the 10th, about 20 Fermi students went to Essanuntuck for the day, and they taught many 4th and 5th graders lessons about leadership, such as making good first impressions, communication skills, speeches, even a lesson on how to tie a tie and look presentable for interviews and such. And Dr. Schumann already mentioned, but last November, a Korean delegation of educators visited Fermi to learn more about our STEAM initiative. And once again tomorrow, Fermi will be hosting another group as with that lady and a bunch of teachers to share our experiences with programs such as Buzz Robotics and our early college experience classes, or ECE classes. Once again, students will be giving them tours around various classrooms and so they can see how we work in action. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you for being outstanding ambassadors. Anything else to add?
No, that's all we have tonight.
Moving on to audiences. Colleen Siniglio?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Colleen Siniglio. I live at 10 Shannon Drive, and these are my daughters, Caitlin and Samantha. They're both middle school students at JFK. I also have an 11th grade daughter at Enfield High School. And the reason I'm here, that I'm here tonight is I would like to discuss or point out a concern I have at the middle school. I sent an email to the principal. I sent several emails to the superintendent, and then we had a phone conversation, and at the end of the conversation, I had said to Dr. Schumann, I'm not happy with this situation. I guess I need to go to the Board of Ed meeting Tuesday night, and he said, excellent idea. So here I am. As by the presentation, there are so many wonderful things happening in Enfield, the middle school being a runner-up for a prestigious award, the pointing out in the PowerPoint that you're trying to provide excellent students or excellent services to all our students. I'm concerned about the JFK walkers being outside prior to school in temperatures below freezing. Now, my daughter, Megan, is a junior at Enfield High. I have never worried about this prior to this year. This year, I have sent a couple of emails. They have been outside in temperatures below 32 degrees. I've been told that the policy is now below 20 degrees and that they are not allowed in the building until the teachers are on duty. At the high school, the students are in the high school when they arrive. If a parent drops a student off at 6:45, they are allowed in the building. There is a warm, safe place for them to be. I was told that I could bring my students to school late, drop them off late. They would not be penalized because they were not going to be allowed in the building without supervision. My concern is they're not supervised outside for that 10 to 15 minutes. I would like them provided, if it needs to be in the budget, a warm, safe place for that 10 minutes prior to school. In the past, they've been allowed in White Wing, and there's been somebody there to watch. I just need to know that if my daughters are dropped off at 7:28 and it's below freezing and it's not that 7:30 time that they're going to open the door, that they can go inside for an extra 2 minutes. If you try and drop your students off after the 7:30 time, the line of traffic is out past the Four Corners, I don't know what the package store is called now, but the package store on the corner, and it's very hard for parents to get in there. There are 27 buses sitting there with seats available. If that's an issue, maybe the students could be put on those buses to wait for a couple of minutes, but they're provided shelter and warmth. They go in immediately when the doors open. So we're talking about probably 60 students that are out there. It should only take one person to supervise. We have bands and choruses that are bigger than 60 students that are supervised by one person. 5 years, never had to worry about this before. Now sending emails saying, you know, it's going to be below freezing, having my husband arrange a schedule to drop them off well after we know the doors are going to be open. So I would like you to look at some way to provide, you know, a hallway, sit them in the cafeteria, two to a table, and tell them they have to read something so that the parents of walkers know that they're covered. You know, my concern, I'm lucky. Like I said, we can make arrangements. There are some students that walk to school that have already been out in the elements for a significant amount of time prior to getting there and standing underneath that white wing overhang waiting. So I would ask you to please look into doing something for those kids in the mornings when it's below freezing. You know, and I would like you to send the message to them. I've asked my daughters, how many fights are there outside of school? How many issues have you guys had as far as they're concerned? I mean, look at these nice faces. They're not in a lot of trouble. Just wait. But anyways, they haven't been a part of any of that. It'd be nice to send the message, we trust you to sit inside against the lockers instead of stand outside and treat them like responsible young adults. The classrooms are locked, the lockers are locked, let them have that hallway space. Would you guys like to add anything? Okay, so would you like to shiver a little bit?
No.
All right, thank you very much for listening. Thank you for taking my phone call, and you know, please consider it in your budget next year, maybe a stipend position or something for a little morning duty for those that are stuck out there when it gets to be the winter months. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Siniglio.
Thank you.
Board member comments. Mr. Neville?
First of all, I had the opportunity to go to Rachel's Challenge right before Christmas there, and a number of you were there as well. It was just fabulous. My compliments to the group, Mr. Kosha, and all of the others that were involved. They just did a great job. It was just touching to see all the kids there, all the families there. I don't know what your total number. I know you were shooting for 1,000. At least I think Mr. Newton was shooting for 1,000. He was making that many pancakes, I think, at least. How many did you get, actually?
We got a little over 500.
Okay. It was just great. It was just a great community activity, and I think all of the things that that go on with Rachel's Challenge. It's just, it pleases me, and it just makes me more fond of this town as to how good the kids are here. And also, now in my retirement years, I have time to work down the food shelf, and I guess some of your students went down there, and the folks down there just raved about how great those kids were. They didn't really know what to expect and how hard they were. They didn't need direction. They just got right into it. So all of those kinds of things, I just wanted to let you guys know just how pleased I was with that. I also had the opportunity to go to the PTO meeting at Crandall and the liaison there, and again, it was just a wonderful opportunity for me. I haven't been to Crandall in a few years, and it was a great group of parents. We ended up having a presentation, which I think we also had a similar one here about the parent leadership group, and a number of the parents there were certainly trying to fit their schedules in so that they could sign up for it. I think Lisa Rogers came and was a speaker there, and she did a great job. They're mostly planning, they're planning some activities and so on, but they also, the principal also spoke about the smarter balanced testing that was coming up, and I believe she gave a website that parents go to, and I know they're very, very interested. What type of test is it? And I think there's some sample ones there, so I'm going to go on myself and just see the types of things they're going and see if I can do them. It was a very positive group. I've also joined the Enfield High School Building Committee, but since Randy's going to be here with his group tonight, I'll let them speak to that. It's a great group of people. They're working their tails off, and I couldn't be happier to be associated with the group. As part of that, and Randy, you may give me some more information on this, there's an OSHA training that's coming up, I believe, on January 25th and February 1st on Saturday from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m., and it has a limited number of folks there, but I was asked to ask the board if anybody here would like to join us. You have to go both days, and you get a certificate.
You get a certification.
Certification.
10 certification.
Right.
Which would allow you to come to the job site and walk around with us and during the construction.
He has
already had my OSHA 10.
Okay, well, if anybody's interested, you know, through the chair, please get a hold of me in the next couple of days, and I'll get the number into Randy or Jim Neruda, and we'll get it straightened out. Other than that, we had a board retreat the other day, which I thought was really, really great. It was good to sit down together and candidly look at what our priorities are and come up with a list of priorities that so that we're all on the same page. That's it.
Ms. Thurston.
Let's see. I have a couple things going on at Eli Whitney. I am the liaison for there. The fifth graders have been doing fundraisers. Their big one right now started, I think, right before Christmas. They're making the loom bracelets. I don't know if your kids do them.
Oh, yes, they do.
Oh, yeah. And the kids, you can sponsor the child, and they will make the bracelets for you. And then tomorrow night at the McDonald's in the ShopRite parking lot, or the ShopRite Plaza, the McDonald's, Eli Whitney is having a fundraiser from 4 to 7. I am going to try to work behind the counter. That'll be interesting. So I encourage you guys to come and get a Happy Meal. So that's it.
Thank you, Stacey. Ms. Ungeier.
Before Christmas, I was able to attend the SafeGrad
that Fermi put on, and it was a great time. And I'm not sure the final numbers of what they raised, but it seemed like they did a really good job. It was well attended. It was so organized, and I really enjoyed myself. I'm the liaison for Hazardville Memorial School, and I was able to go over there and spend some time with Bonnie Mazzoli. And she gave me a tour of the whole school and met the teachers, and I really enjoyed doing that. And it seems like she's doing a bang-up job over there. I also attended the PTO that they had last week and met with Lisa Carey, and they have a lot of interesting things going on there and some fundraisers that will be coming up. So that's it.
Thank you, Ms. Ungar. Mr. Wauer.
I do want to recognize Brendan Walsh and many others who helped coordinate the event at St. Patrick's Church. Very, very well-done event, well-attended, and we'll continue to follow that. I want to thank the administration for educating me every week on this wonderful program, and look forward to participating in future programs. January 2nd, I was over at Henry Barnard. I happened to be in the neighborhood, so I stopped by to talk with the principal for just a few minutes, and she had the opportunity to give me a quick tour of rooms at the school. This was not the coldest day, but it was pretty tough teaching, as I observed in some of the classrooms, and which raised a few questions in my mind about, is this happening in other elementary schools as well? It's not. But I was made aware that there are some building maintenance issues that are being addressed but need to kind of be stepped up a little bit. I would hope that our wonderful buildings and grounds folks coordinate the superintendent's office and get some of these issues addressed so that our teachers don't have to wear coats and kids don't have to go into another classroom where there's actually heat in order to learn. And again, I have to commend the staff of the school there for making the best of what was going on in light of the environment inside the building. It was darn cold outside. And I'm not sure exactly, it was in December, had the opportunity to go to the Lamplighters' final production of their play at Enfield High. And it was, while the attendance was probably not as much as the students would have hoped, it was still a rousing performance, and I have to give them kudos to them and to their advisors and to the parent volunteers who did all the work and made it a wonderful production.
Thank you, Mr. Wauer. Well, first, I am the school liaison for the Enfield Street School. I attended my first PTO meeting. I have to give a shout out to Liz Davis and her program of the Parent Leadership Academy. I strongly recommend that anyone who has children currently in school that wants to become an effective, involved parent in their education, I will tell you, by all means, please take advantage of that program. You can reach Ms. Davis, and she'll gladly take you on. Also, we have a very important program that's coming up that I strongly believe in, and that's Enfield First Readers. They're having their very first fundraiser. That will be Saturday, February 22nd, 2014, at 7 p.m. at the Mount Carmel Society, which is 93 Park Avenue here in Enfield. The Enfield First Readers is a tremendous program. It recognizes the accomplishment of reading your first book and comprehending your first book. The fundraiser is a trivia night. I went to the one last year. I had a ball. It's a lot of fun. You get to hang out with your neighbors. It's very entertaining. It's just a great, great time for a great, great cause. The teams, you can have team members of a team table of up to 8 members. The cost for that is $120. That includes a reserve table. And the individual cost, and they'll gladly put a team together for you if you have nothing going on that night or you really want to attend and don't you can't manage to put a team together is $20 a person. You can buy the tickets at www.firstreaders.org. You can buy them in person from at the Enfield Resources for Children at 50 Post Office Road here in Enfield. And you can also purchase them by getting in touch with a very good friend of mine, Judy Aparisi DeRose, by calling her on her cell phone at 860-214-7477 or by emailing her at japrizzi@gmail.com. Again, I want to thank everyone who attended the Board of Ed retreat. Our unofficial motto for this year is getting everyone on the same page. We came up with that because, again, we're focusing on the communication aspect of the thing, and we're trying to get everyone to understand exactly what it is that the board does and have a true involvement with everyone in our community. I think we set some tremendous goals for ourselves. They're very attainable, but they're going to take some hard work. As you could tell from Dr. Schumann, thank you, Dr. Schumann, for your presentation today, that it is budget season, unfortunately. Budget season is my least favorite part of this job. The reason for it is that you get to see how much we could do and how much we are made to do that prevents us from doing what we would like to do. I do recognize that we live in a community that we're not as wealthy as we could be, and that's a reality. So there are lots of things, again, with the unfunded mandates. If we had the support from the state that we're supposed to have, we'd be fine. I mean, we could achieve a lot. Unfortunately, as Dr. Schumann pointed out very early in his presentation, they get in the way of a lot of things. I want to commend Buzz Robotics again for coming out. I do believe in and very strongly support them. And one of the other things that we've been talking is also a goal, is the continuations of the public and private partnerships, especially in education. The goal here is to provide a very good education for our children and a competitive education for our children and prepare them for the workforce of tomorrow. Public-private partnerships lower that cost significantly. And they're not mandatory, they're voluntary. And the good thing about that is you actually go back to the old days of education and the good part of it, where your local economy dictates what your education system looks like. You get to not only develop the skills necessary to get into the workforce, but you keep the workforce local, which is what we all want. Because if we have a local workforce, we have an expanded tax base. And if we have an expanded tax base, we can afford many things. That's it for my comments, and we'll be moving on. Unfinished business, which will be continuing the discussion regarding the use of the Enrico Fermi building.
Mr. Chairman, we have no new information for you this evening. I did notice that, or you all noticed that under 11D, you're going to be considering setting up the subcommittee that's going to work with us to establish those strategies we talked about last time, the website, and moving ourselves forward. So I think that would be great for us to be able to have that group to have a direct contact to, and then we can move the discussion forward.
Can we start discussing that at this level, or do we have to wait till we actually get to the agenda item?
You should really wait until you get to the agenda
item,
because we have some folks who want to present to you in the next few items.
Next on the list is the Enfield High School Building Committee presentation and the approval of the EDO 42 plans and specifications. Mr. Vindigny? Or excuse me. Mr. Daigle, sorry.
Oh, I've been called worse.
Good evening. I am Dean Petroselli with Silver Petroselli and Associates. We are the architects on the Enfield High School project, and I am obviously the principal of the firm and the chief architect on the project. Tonight's a milestone for the project. We are presenting, or at least seeking your approval and signatures for the O42 form, which is a form required by the state of Connecticut before a project can be released for bid. The drawings and specifications and estimates need to be presented to the state of Connecticut, and one of their requisitions or requirements is that we get approval from the building committee, the Board of Ed, and superintendent. So those three signatures are required on the O42 form that I have with me tonight. What we're virtually approving is the first of three phases of this project. And a little step back, I think you're all aware that this project is what we call fast-tracked. Phase one is the fast track of the Fermi wing, the steam addition wing of the building. It's the largest of five additions that are slated for the building. And the fast track incorporates the structural steel, the structural concrete, and the site package only. So the first phase, again, phase one of three, is a small piece, but a very critical piece, which is allowing construction to start much sooner than if the state waited for the entire set of documents to be complete. So again, tonight's phase is really approval of phase one, which is the civil package, everything on the site, the structural package for Fermi, and the concrete package for Fermi. There's three pieces of this set of documents. There's a spec, which is a written manual. There's a set of drawings, which consists of about 100 drawings for this first phase. It's going to be probably the smallest of all the phases. I would venture to guess there's going to be probably close to about 500 or 600 drawings on phase two. So this is a relatively small phase. And there's an estimate that goes along with this 042 form. The estimate is produced by Gilbane Construction, who is the construction managers on the project. I think you're all aware that the budget for this project is $103 million. This first phase, again, steel, concrete, and civil, represents $14,646,553. So again, a $14 million or $14.6 million portion. I'm not sure how much detail you want to go in. Really what the state is looking for is the signature of the chairman of the Board of Ed that you folks are, and I'll use the exact language, that the project has been reviewed and approved by this board. Again, it is a requirement of a state statute by the state of Connecticut that we get Board of Ed approval, building committee approval, and superintendent approval. So I'm willing to open up 100 drawings and go over each of them one by one. But obviously, they're here if you want to take a look at them at your convenience. Again, they consist of drawings, specs, and an estimate. And really, at the end of the day, I have an 042 form that can only be one live active form. I need all three live signatures on one single form. And we really would hope to leave tonight with the signature and approval of this board. It is required that you make a motion and approve this process. And then I'll need the chairman's signature on my 042 form. And I'm not sure if there's any questions and how much in depth you want me to go into those drawings and specs.
Go ahead, Mr. Neville.
Yeah, my understanding is, and I appreciate what you need out of this, and I think we can do that fairly quickly. This is one step along the way to get to, you have a meeting on the 21st, is it?
We have our PCT, which is next Tuesday up at the state. That's an acronym for Plan Completion Test. So this is the process leading up to that PCT. That is correct.
This has to be done prior to that, or we can't do that. And that could delay going out to bid and so on, right?
Absolutely. If we don't meet that deadline. Right now, for us to start construction in May of this year, which is what Gilbane is slated, it all relies on a successful PCT. In the month of January, and us getting approval by the month of February and being able to go out to bid by March.
Okay. As, just to put it in English, we're digging the hole, we're pouring the concrete, we're putting up the steel with these drawings?
That's correct. We're digging a hole, we're pushing around dirt on the site, we're digging holes, and we're putting up steel and concrete.
That's what
correct.
I thought. So basically it's the
superstructure
building,
yes. Of the facility, correct. Oh, just of the Fermi wing.
Of just the Fermi wing. And
correct.
This is the first of how many phases?
This is the first of three phases.
Mr. Wauer?
Could you provide the board with a description of the three phases, bullet points?
Sure.
Tonight, but it would be helpful.
I can really rattle off very quickly. Phase one is this fast track portion of steel, concrete, and civil. Phase two is what you would really consider the balance of the project. And phase three is FF&E, which is an acronym for furnitures, fixture, and equipment. FF&E by the state of Connecticut must be bid as a second separate package. So there really is only one significant package. Phase two really is the lion's share of the project.
Any other questions?
Do you have the motion?
Yeah, could I entertain a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion that we approve ED 042 plans and specifications as presented.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Grady?
No.
Ms. LeBlanc? Mr. Neville? Ms. Thurston? Mr. Janitis? Ms. Unghire?
Yes.
Mr. Wauer?
Yes.
Chairman Sirard?
Yes.
Motion passes.
One thing while Dean's getting the signatures, I just want to mention that based on the referendum, we were supposed to have this project completed in 2017 by allowing this, having the state allow us to go fast track, which is the second project they've ever done this way. We were able to shave a year off. So that's why we're going to be having certificate of occupancy in September of 2016. Also, we were planning on breaking ground in June of this year, but due to all the meetings we've had and the success with the drawings and meeting all recommendations from you guys and the Board of Ed and the Town Council, everybody working together, we were able to break ground. We're looking at hopefully the second week of May now. So we're ahead of schedule breaking ground, and we're ahead of schedule on completing it. So it's been a great relationship with the Board of Ed and the Town Council. I've done a lot of projects with this town, and it is a great, great relationship we have. We've never been held up on anything. We've asked for help. You guys have been there. So on behalf of the Building Committee, we just truly would like to thank you guys for everything that you guys have been doing to get this project where it is. So.
Thank you, guys. We appreciate it.
And thank you, Mr. Daigle, and I want to thank your committee on behalf of the Board of Education for all the hard work that you guys have done.
Thank you very much.
We have to approve the high school 2014-16 program of studies.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, we have Fermi High School Assistant Principal Marilyn Crisati here with us. If you have any questions regarding this, you maybe want to offer some comments. Enfield High School Assistant Principal Mr. Saligalski was going to attend, but he is at a basketball game this evening for Enfield High, so Mrs. Crisati will carry the load for the team.
Hi. On December 18th, Mr. Sargalski and I presented to the Board of Ed Subcommittee our program of studies for the years 2014-2016. If anybody would like to take any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Does any board member have a question? Mr. Wauer.
I'll just ask one because I did read the 125 pages. I have to applaud the members of the curriculum committee who worked with you to bring it to the board. So I'm not going to go into too great detail, but for the future, I'm just curious. Well, when I looked at foreign languages, where we have French and Spanish, I know they're Spanish. I can understand some global value to that, but I'm kind of wondering because. When I went to public school, there are more than two languages, and I'm not. And again, for future dialogue and discussions, not this curriculum, but I kind of question the relevance of the French versus something else. But I'm just putting it out, not for today's, but for the next group that comes back in 2017 or something.
2016. It'll 16. Be our first program of studies for the new high school.
2016, then.
Yes. Thank you.
Mr. If I could just respond, that most we had four or five languages at one time, and they've been cut back for a variety of reasons, but mostly due to budget. and French and Spanish are the ones that we have been able to keep. We recently cut Latin. Mm-hmm. We used to have German. We used to have Italian.
Russian.
Years ago, yeah. And so, but for a lot of reasons, and but mostly budget, they've been trimmed back, and we have both French and Spanish.
Any other board comments or questions? Can I entertain a motion to approve the high school 2014-2016 program of studies?
I move that we approve the 2014-16 program of studies.
Second. Mr. Drezek, roll call, please.
Mr. Grady? Ms. LeBlanc? Mr. Neville?
Yes.
Ms. Thurston?
Yes.
Mr. Janitis? Ms. Ungheyer?
Yes.
Mr. Wauer?
Yes.
Chairman Sirard?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Very good.
Thank you very much.
Moving along, we have to approve the Capital Community College EMT Paramedic Program Resolution. Dr. Schumann.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The board this evening has the opportunity to continue its participation in the Capital Community College EMT Paramedic Program. The board has participated for over 15 years. This is an opportunity for students to become involved in a paramedic program internship type exposure. As you read in the memo we sent to you, students have come from all across the Hartford area, and actually some of these students have actually responded to EMS calls in our schools. There is no cost to the board. It's an opportunity for our students. So if the board is in the mind that they wish to continue, they can take an action to advise us to continue with this program.
Is there any comments or questions from the board?
I've witnessed it in the past, and it's very, very productive. The only question I have is there any liability to us, or are they covered by the group that they're coming from in terms of insurance?
That's a great question, Mr. Neville. I don't know the exact answer to that. I do know that the town has a very broad umbrella policy for liability, as you know, as we all know. If something does happen, certainly the town would be cited, and the liability would fall probably to both organizations. But I can research that and find out for you.
Okay. My assumption would be that if we approve it, then we're at least owning part of that responsibility. For any other group that we have we approve, we would have something. It was just a question that came up when I read it in the agenda, and I just want, if you could, I'm assuming it's okay, but if you could just check on that, I would appreciate it, and get back to the chair and just let him know.
Yes, I will do that.
Mr. Wauer? So are you recommending that we hold off on the approval, Mr. Neville?
Not necessarily. I'm comfortable. We've done this for years, and you know, my assumption is we're covered. I'm comfortable enough moving it on. And obviously, if we find out that it's not true, we can reconsider it at that point.
Being very clear on that, it's been a program that we've been in partnership with for 15 years. I don't have an issue with it. Do I have a motion to approve?
Make a motion that we approve the Capital Community College EMT Paramedic Program.
Thank you, Mr. Warren.
Second. Second.
Seconded by Mr. Neville. Mr. Drezek.
Mr. Grady. Ms. LeBlanc. Mr. Neville.
Yes.
Ms. Thurston.
Yes.
Mr. Janitis. Ms. Ungheyer.
Yes.
Mr. Wauer.
Yes.
Chairman Sirard.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Now we get to establish the Enrico Fermi Future Use Board Committee. Now, this is a temporary subcommittee of the Board of Education, which means all we have to do is a simple vote, and we can establish it. It will be disassembled after it's been determined. And my understanding and is the Enrico Fermi Future Use Board Committee will make recommendations to us, the Board of Education, as to the educational use of Fermi, should we determine that there is an educational use for Fermi. Are there any comments on this issue?
I'm wondering whether we should make, do we need to vote on this? Or is it something that the chair can set up a committee? It's my understanding you could set up a committee along the way. I'm not sure you need a particular vote for it. That's the only reason I'm asking.
That's why I can just do it on my own?
Yes, I think I
do have some questions about
it. All right, so we're going to be setting up, how's that? We're going to be setting up the Enrico Fermi Future Use Board Committee. I will open the floor to any comments or questions as to what it's going to look like. So go ahead, Mr. Neville.
I'm interested in getting some feedback in here. The public needs to be included in this, but I think we have to set some parameters, okay? First of all, I think we need to define the task of the committee. And I think, Tom, you defined it quite well, and I think you just restated that pretty much the same as you did at the last meeting, that we have to decide whether there's a need, an educational need, to maintain the Fermi building. I think we need to define what that charge, what we want from that charge. And I'm going to give a couple of examples here. We need people are going to be coming up with various uses. We've heard it being used as a an alternate school, another middle school. We've heard it being used for a what's Peter, the one Peter's always talking about, the trade school, something like that. And I'm sure there's a variety of other types of educational uses that it could be used as. My concern is if we open it up without setting some parameters, okay, what would you like to do? Well, I'd like to have it be a K-3 building, okay, just because that's something that we probably wouldn't do. There would be obviously a lot of cost involved. So there may be some people who would be interested in that. But if I said I'm looking for a K-3 building and there's going to be a $42 million referendum that we have to go out, that's going to change my mind. Okay, and it's that ridiculous for that particular use. So I'm thinking that if we're going to put out a use, we should talk about a couple of things. One, define what the use is. Let's just say a K-3 building. Detail what year it would be used for that purpose. When do we want to use it for that? When do we need it, in other words, as part of that recommendation? Define in general terms if the new use requires any expenditures of funds. Can we move right in there? Or is there going to be an expenditure of funds? If there are going to be expenditures of funds, approximate whether it would take a referendum to get those funds, because we have a clear dollar amount, I believe. Is it $2.5 million or something like that? There's a clear dollar amount that you have to go to get a referendum. And I think if the new use closes another school, approximate how long the renovations would take and when we would close the other school. And finally, have a timeline. I like to have beginnings and ends on things. I think the public needs to be part of this. So if we put a timeline out there with benchmarks, periodic benchmarks along the way, where we have at least one, maybe several meetings, where people would hear what the committee is doing and then also have a chance to ask the committee questions and get answers, if not then afterwards, if we don't have the answers that night. So those are the kinds of things I'm throwing out. It's not that I don't want to hear a lot of things, but I think they could send us off in a lot of directions, whereas if we were asked for $42 million to do something right now, the town council would you know, ask us where our brains were, okay, and be correct about it. And if we were looking for it to be used in the year after, or the year that the high school opens, the question would be, what happens to that payment plan that we have to pay the state? Because we have a waiver, Dr. Schumann, since you notified them that we were looking at not using it, so they kind of put us on hold.
That is correct.
And my understanding is if we were to tell them that we're not on hold anymore, the clock starts ticking again.
That would be correct also.
Okay. So I'm just looking to get those kinds of things out there. Thank you.
To answer one of your questions, the first thing is I believe it's 1% of your total budget is what the threshold is for referendum. I could be wrong, but that's the number that seems to stick in my head. Again, with regarding to the task at hand for this committee, it's because we will be dealing with the public and we will be dealing with a lot of information, as I thought it would be appropriate to establish a committee to, much like the building committee, to in order to collect this information and make recommendations to the board. I am open to the idea of having non-board members be part of that committee. I haven't made up my mind on that, and that's leaving that up to the board as a whole. This is just, I think it would facilitate the conversation, especially if you had one or two members from the public on that board, not in a leadership capacity, but at least as a membership capacity. Again, this is a board decision. I agree with you, Mr. Neville, that the decision is there an academic use? That's the first priority. And second, if there is an academic use, what would that use be? I think everything else is secondary. We have, the previous board has voted to turn the building back to the town, which has given us a reprieve, if you say, or a stay of execution as far as the handicap accessibility issues are concerned. Again, and I think a very major factor on this is going to be cost. That's something that really, really needs to be looked at in comparison to other uses. That's just my take on it, again, but I'm leaving it open to the board. So, Mr. Waller?
Well, I agree in philosophy that the scope of such a committee should be narrower than broader. But I also believe that the public should have a role in this. So I would like to see members of the public participate. And whether the chairman decides it's going to be 5 or 6 or 10 or whatever, just like the council did on its charter revision commission, the chair could set a boundary of X men or between X men, X many people, and have people just apply and submit names of superintendent. And then in the interim, we could look at a kind of a plan of action. We're obviously, in addition to having members of the public on an active role, outreach, community outreach. And I was watching the charter revision process described, and I don't think it's unrealistic that we kind of look at that model in terms of some of the public outreach criteria. And then ultimately, whatever the input is back to the full board, that we've thoroughly vetted, because I look at this as it's not an opportunity to look at one building, it's an opportunity to look at the system. We did a systematic approach 5 years ago, and it resulted in some changes. This could conceivably result in other changes, I call them building operations type, because we should look at this holistically.
Mr. Neville.
I'm not against getting some involvement, although I worry about the logistics trying to get people together. It's look at this board table. We're missing a group of people right now, and this is a regularly scheduled meeting. And having served, I think you have as well, Mr. Warr, on other, I've served demographic committees and stuff like that. I hate to say it, but it's chronically a problem to try to get a full committee there, and what you end up doing is going back and revisiting this stuff. I understand everybody's obligations and stuff, but it's very, very difficult. I think the other thing is that I don't see this. I liked it when you started saying it was more narrower than broader, but then when you started saying we're looking at it as a system thing, I guess I'm in total disagreement with that. We have one topic on the table here. We're not looking at redefining the school system. We did that already, and we have a town council board committee that did that and did it for several years. We're looking at whether this town, this school system, has a need to keep to use that building as an educational institution. Okay, I think that's a fairly narrow thing. And if we expand it beyond that, then I think we're also leading people on that they can make other decisions there. That's why I wanted to define the charge clearly.
Well, let me just rephrase it from a perspective of programs within the buildings. That I wasn't talking about the buildings, but when you look at a building, you look at what could be inside the building. So that's what I was referring to. I wasn't referring necessarily to revisiting all the other buildings, but rather programs currently.
Maybe I misinterpreted what you were saying. I apologize.
I was actually hoping that we would have more board members present, so that everyone understands. As a deliberative board, we can only meet when we meet, otherwise, which is why this is on the agenda and why we're hammering it out now. We don't usually get an opportunity to sit down as a full board and discuss these off the table. Although I have every intent of establishing the future use committee, I'm going to hold off until the next meeting. What I'm going to request all of the board members do is put some serious thought into it, see what you would like to see it shape out to be, and then at the next meeting, we will, again, I want to put this as an agenda item for the next meeting so everyone will understand where it's going, and we'll have a definitive plan. Again, the reason that it was put on the agenda, I was hoping for more board input, but we're barely a board right now, so I'm going to move on. Board committee reports. Are there any?
Yes.
Mr. Neville.
Curriculum committee, we met right before Christmas, and as it was stated when we talked about the program of studies, we did review that, and the committee felt comfortable presenting it, bringing it back to the full board for approval. I think, additionally reviewed the promotion retention policy. I forget the exact number there. And we are going to discuss it again in our January meeting. And at some point, when we're ready, we're going to recommend bring it to the policy committee and then to the full board for a first reading to look at that. I think we'll also be looking at Mr. Cannon brought up some responses to some of the things were brought up at the meeting of the 10th, I believe, in terms of questions that we had about other school districts and so on, and we had a good discussion about that as well. And I believe the minutes were in your packet that was sent out on Friday. Thank you.
Any other committee reports? Ms. Ungar.
Tomorrow morning I'm attending a CREC meeting in Hartford, so I'll let you know how that goes and bring back some information.
Good. Very good. Thank you. Last time, any other committee reports?
CABE has meetings coming up in the next couple of months that I've signed up for, so we'll have reports back on CABE in February and in March.
Very good. Moving on, approval of minutes. Regular meeting minutes December 10th, 2013. Do I have a motion to accept those minutes?
Move to accept those minutes.
Do I have a second? All those in favor, a show of hands.
Aye.
Passes. We have the approval of the minutes for the special meeting on December 17th, 2013. Do I have a motion to accept the minutes?
Move to accept those minutes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Do I show of hands, who approves? Motion passes, they're approved. We have no approval of accounts and payroll.
A meeting's tomorrow, I think.
That is, yes. The Finance Committee is tomorrow. Correspondence and communications, the Secretary is not here. Do we have any correspondence and communications, Dr. Schumann?
Not to my knowledge, Mr. Chairman.
Very good. Do we have any further audiences from the audience? No, we do not. Do we have a need for executive session?
No, we do not, Mr. Chairman.
Do I have a motion to adjourn? Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
Oh, Tata, that was.